Good morning, and welcome to another episode of Homebrew. I'm Michael Unterman, Artistic Director of the Five Boroughs Music Festival, and that was a cumbia, a Colombian folk rhythm and folk dance, played by Rafael Leal, who is a drummer, percussionist, composer, teacher, and author, originally from Colombia and now a proud resident of Queens, New York. And he'll be our special guest a little bit later on this morning. Rafael was one of seven Queens-based musicians who were interviewed as part of a commission project called The Emigrants, which was written by composer George Lam for the cello and percussion duo New Morse Code. And this episode of Homebrew is in celebration of the studio album release of this piece, recently released through Bandcamp, and we hope you will check that out. If you've ever found yourself in need of an occasional reminder that there is vital and important music being created and performed out there, as well as a reminder that we are surrounded by people from countless backgrounds, each with a meaningful story to tell. So that's probably all of us, that we could probably use a sort of a helpful nudge along those lines from time to time, then you'll want to buy this album on Bandcamp of New Morse Code performing George Lam's The Emigrants. So maybe while you're listening to the recording, which will air here, and which George has shrewdly added a handy link to the Bandcamp page, you can maybe open a new tab and head on over there. The link will be posted. And as I said, it'll be on the screen as well. Check that out. And I think it's $4 or $5. Just buy a copy of the album. It's really wonderful, as you will hear soon. So some quick housekeeping. For those of you who are new to Five Boroughs Music Festival, welcome. We are a concert series that presents chamber music in all shapes and sizes across the five boroughs of New York City. We will be putting out a series of five original programs this year, starting with streamed video productions and hopefully building up to some live in-person events by the season's end. If you are interested in staying in touch, please sign up for our mailing list, which is at 5bmf.org, and just scroll down to the bottom of the page. You can also follow us, of course, on Facebook and Instagram. We will keep you posted there as well. Homebrew, then, is our online summer series, which we launched really sort of with a spirit of keeping the show going on, so to speak, during these uncertain times. We feel it's really important to offer set fees to all of the artists who appear on this series, but we're also asking, so that we can continue to offer these, that you consider making a modest donation to 5BMF. You know, whatever you think is good, $5, $20, and you can do that very easily either through our Facebook page or at 5bmf.org/support. We have some really cool stuff coming up next weekend. Pianist Yeva Yukubavichute will be, she was the pianist in Trio Cavatina, who appeared on our series a little while ago, and she'll be offering a short solo piano recital with music by Bach, Mozart, Brahms, and the Norwegian composer Lasse Thoresen. A couple weeks later, then, on Sunday, September 13th, we'll be celebrating the release of a beautiful new music video by the piano trio Long Leash, who performed in our series back in January. It's a recording and video of Pauline Oliveros's tree piece. And there may be an episode in the intervening weekend as well. We're working to put something together. So stay tuned. So among today's guests, Hannah Collins, the cellist in New Morse Code, is actually a soon-to-be alum of Five Boroughs Music Festival. She'll be performing in a concert that will probably be airing in early October. And it's a co-production, so I'm not exactly sure how much more I can reveal. But if you want to be the first to know about that concert, please join our mailing list again at 5bmf.org. Scroll to the bottom of the page. And the other half of New Morse Code is percussionist Michael Compitello. And I am so happy to welcome them both to the stream. Their work combines an extremely engaging curatorial vision. They are thoughtful and virtuosic both, and are just sweet and lovely people. It's no surprise to me that they are newly the assistant or co-directors of the Avaloc Farm, which is a sort of retreat center for kind of an incubator center for all kinds of awesome musical projects. You can find out more about them at newmorsecode.com and all the social media channels as well. And the composer, George Lam, who is also joining us, is an incredibly accomplished individual who has lived the immigrant experience himself, coming to the US from Hong Kong. He studied here, taught here, wrote pieces for the likes of Chautauqua Opera, the American Opera Project, Gotham Chamber Opera, Rhymes with Opera, and many others. He is now back in Hong Kong and is calling us late on a school night. He's 12 hours ahead, now teaching at Hong Kong Baptist University. And so without further ado, I am very happy to welcome to the stream Hannah Collins, Michael Compitello, and George Lam. And here we are. One more here.
Hi, Michael.
Hi, Michael.
Hi, everyone.
How's it going this morning?
It's going well.
This morning, late at night, George.
Yeah, no. Thank you so much for inviting us.
Yeah, this is great.
So happy to have you all here. So yeah, I wanted to start with kind of a broad ranging question. I've kind of been just sort of taken with this idea, and maybe it is, you know, that we all have a little more time on our hands than we might like in certain senses, you know, not running from gig to gig as we sometimes do. And just thinking of this idea of just how wonderful it is to really have this like a big project that you sort of sit with, that you work on, you know, for months and months and months. George, this is probably a very familiar experience to you, but I think for you know, sort of performing gigging musicians, it's such a treat to be able to have projects like this. And I just was wondering if maybe you all could sort of talk a little bit about that through New Morse Code's work, through Avaloc Farm, and your work as a composer. Sort of what does it mean to be able to just take the time in that way?
I can start. I think one thing that Mike and I founded New Morse Code sort of more on a feeling and on a principle than on any specific, you know, concert program or set of future plans. And it was having a feeling that we knew thoroughly the music we were playing and were ready to advocate for it for a long period of time. You know, I think as performing musicians, we often find ourselves in situations where other constraints really affect how comfortably we can work and understand what's going on. Specifically with a commission, you know, oftentimes the composer has done an incredible amount of work 2 months ago, and then the performer gets this, you know, window to do an incredible amount of work, you know, 3 days before the concert. And there's this sort of asynchronous process. And part of slowing things down for us means that we can both the composer and performer spending more time in the sort of non-peak part of that stress, just brainstorming it and bringing those asynchronous processes together. Avoiding those moments of like, if I could have only talked to George about this passage 2 months ago and not the day before the concert, we could have totally come up with something, a solution to this little technical problem, things like that. So it's a big part of our philosophy to try to be in the same space at the same time and see where that leads us.
Mm-hmm. And I'd say that's, I mean, I feel so lucky being able to work on this project with both Hannah and Mike from the beginning. And I feel lucky, I continue to feel lucky because, you know, it hasn't been just a one-off thing, and we've continued the conversation and we have continued working on this all the way to the release, really. And from the very beginning, when we were brainstorming ideas, we're thinking about, you know, hey, what would a piece be like that would be relevant to new Morse code? So we came up with the theme of being expatriates, or being sort of removed from where you first lay down roots, and because that's something that's common. It's a common theme to me, of course, as you mentioned, Michael, that I moved to America, but also to Hannah and Mike, who have spent, you know, a considerable amounts of time outside of the country, and also just also knowing people who have, you know, and like we all do. So that's one sort of part I think that was really great in working with them to think about how to create this piece. But also to Hannah's point, you know, we actually had the opportunity to workshop a little bit. I flew, oh my gosh, it sounds so weird to say I flew somewhere. I flew to Kansas City for a weekend, to Kansas, Lawrence, Kansas, which is close to Kansas City, to work out sort of some of the sounds that you'll hear in the piece. Because writing for percussion for me has always been very difficult because I can't really hear things in my head because there's so many different possibilities. A cymbal sounds like a million cymbals. And so it was really great to just have a weekend just to jam and to think about, and you know, what would go into the piece. And that collaboration process has gone all the way through to the concert.
Very cool. The one thing I wanted to know a little bit more about from New Morse Code is the sort of overarching project New Morse Connections.
New Morse Connections was sort of a way for us to sort of organize some of our bigger ideas. You know, as Hannah mentioned, one thing that's important to us is sort of developing work with our friends and collaborators. But I think that the sort of second part of that that's probably more important is the sort of connection that you build with everybody else around the work that you create. You know, I think for us, we feel a lot more motivated when what we do is not just in a vacuum, but when it helps connect people, or it helps create a sense of community around what we're doing. And so last year, we took on three projects, George's piece, The Emigrants, an opera by Susan Kander called Driving While Black, which we just were working on the audio recording the last couple of days, and a piece by David Crowell called Catharsis, which is written for cello, percussion, and many other cello and percussions, which can either be live or pre-recorded. And each of those was sort of designed for us, on the one hand, to connect with people that we care about, and on the other hand, for us to take part in ideas and issues that we feel really passionately about. But typically, as classical musicians, we're not able to sort of be as activist as we'd like to be. So it was a way for us to sort of connect to right now as much as we could. Hannah, I don't know if you have any other thoughts on that.
That's the idea. New Morse Connections was a Kickstarter campaign, and it's also a way of bringing our sort of musical family into the projects as they were in progress. So not only like the composer and the performer, but also the future consumer or listener, or to kind of get a sneak peek and just understand why we were doing this. Because again, it's sort of like that moment of just the performance or just the release of the album. This is like not a lot of time for information to get exchanged. So it was a way for us to explain ourselves a little bit more, but also like circle up some support and some conversation.
Very cool. All right. Well, without further ado, maybe we'll stream. This is sort of part one, or the movements one and two of The Emigrants. And actually, I just got a little message that the sound might have been a bit garbled of the little recording of Rafael, so I might play that again as a quick lead-in to the performance. And I'll be back after the second movement, just to introduce a sort of short pre-recorded interview we did with Rafael. So yeah, thanks all of you, and we'll see you at the tail end of the show. Wow.
I am only six miles away from this.
My dream when I worked in Colombia was to live here. Know them, my heroes. I knew my heroes lived here, especially in New York. I was the last. I came here in almost 10 years ago, in 2007.
Came by myself, but I struggled a lot for the first couple of years, but eventually I got into college and I did all my studies in music at Queen's College.
Why don't we move instead of back and forth? And both me and my daughter, we were missing being with him. When I was moving here, I wasn't even sure that there was going to be an opportunity for me here.
Came here without any idea that I would come here and live here, because I guess I didn't have the brains to understand why am I flying to another place from Hong Kong at that age, because I didn't know why I was here.
My idea was like, I want to go to New York. I didn't have any idea what New York was.
Because I didn't know why I was here.
I started to work in a restaurant, in the dishwasher. Did that for 4 months.
Came to the US because everything sounded fantastic. Everybody was very enthusiastic and very involved. The first time that I went to Corona, walking out of the train in Manhattan was a weird shock, cultural shock, to realize I am only 6 miles away from this, and there's a 1,000 miles culturally of disconnect between these two places.
And in 2008, I went to the U.S. I came to the U.S. and toured three cities, Fort Wayne and New York and Boston. I really, really wondered how I can continue my music activities in the U.S. I have to quit my activities in Japan.
And by the time we started
came by myself
coming here,
but struggled a lot for the first couple of years. But
came to New York,
we moved to New York.
I would say a treasure of music.
I was
6 months
away from
listening to music. So we thought, why don't we move instead of back and forth
And both me and my daughter, we were missing being with him.
That's how we got here.
So I teach to him every day about that, about look at this, look at that, all these.
I started playing music as a child.
On their list.
It seemed pretty natural to me to come to the States to study music.
My first instrument was piano.
At the same time, and I started to teach in music schools in here in Jackson Heights.
About that, about look at this, look at that, all these deserve respect.
We grew up always with the idea that we couldn't do it. It was just not possible. And then seeing kids that looked like us, that had the same challenges and difficulties that we had, were doing it.
That was not enough for me just to study at the university.
So I had the idea of as I said, to start working with Guatemalan community.
That was not enough for me just to study at the university.
Because by the time I was working on my second book.
While I was here, actually, I became very interested in starting a program with the Guatemalan immigrant community here in New York.
I always wanted to do it, and I never had the chance to, because I was never afforded to.
We grew up always with the idea that we couldn't do it. It was just not possible. And then seeing kids that looked like us, that had the same challenges and difficulties that we had, were doing it.
Maybe it's never too late to learn music.
I still keep listening and I still learn a lot.
So I teach to him every day about that, about look at this, look at that, all these.
Well, some books, many books, library books as well, how to read music.
About 15 to 20 years of learning is a very normal process before.
I thought that was not enough for me just to study at the
university.
We grew
up always with the idea that we couldn't do it. It was just not possible. And then seeing kids that looked like us, that had the same challenges and difficulties that we had, were doing it. That idea of you cannot do it, we cannot do it, it's so ingrained in our culture and in our psyche that it's really, really, really serious.
I still keep listening and I still learn a lot.
Maybe it's never too late to learn music.
Hi, thanks for joining us. That was the first two movements of The Emigrants, performed by New Morse Code, composed by George Lam. And now I'm really pleased to air just a short extract of some answers to some interview questions that the drummer that you saw at the top, Rafael Leal, and who you heard speaking at a number of moments in that first half. These are some answers to questions about his sort of how he found his way to music as a youngster in Colombia, and then how he found his way to the United States. So really happy to show this to you. Just one moment, we'll cue it up.
Okay. Cuando yo vivía en Colombia, yo crecí en un vecindario de clase media, en las afueras de Bogotá, la ciudad donde nací. Mi niñez fue tranquila hasta cierto punto. Cuando llegué a la adolescencia, empecé a tener otros intereses diferentes a los de la familia. Los últimos años de mi niñez, yo recuerdo que tenía un vecino que escuchaba música clásica a alto volumen en la casa de al lado, y a mí me gustaba escuchar esa música. Ese fue tal vez mi primer contacto con la música. Después yo quería tomar lecciones de piano y le decía a mi mamá que quería tomar lecciones, que quería un piano, y mi mamá me decía, no hay plata para comprar un piano. Aparte de eso, me decía que los músicos, que no era bueno que fuera músico porque a los músicos les gustaba el alcohol y esas cosas. En cierto momento me fui a la casa, y cuando me fui a la casa yo tenía unos 22 años, tal vez. Conocí, no, un poco antes de eso, yo había conocido unos amigos que tenían un grupo de rock and roll, en el barrio donde yo vivía, y yo los seguía. Me empecé a interesar otra vez por la música y conseguí un tamborcito pequeño, una conga. Entonces yo iba detrás de ellos con mi conga y me escondía por ahí en algún lugar mientras ellos tocaban, y trataba de seguir lo que ellos tocaban. Y ahí fui aprendiendo. Después pude tener una batería. Empecé a tocar la batería por mi cuenta, siguiendo canciones de los Beatles. Y poco a poco, fue pasando el tiempo, empecé a progresar un poco con el instrumento. Me fui de la casa. Ya cuando me fui de la casa, tuve más libertad, más oportunidad para seguir tocando. Conocí músicos y empecé, tal vez ahí comenzó mi carrera musical. Tal vez a los 23 años, algo así, un poco tarde. Realmente ya estaba viejo para eso, pero lo hice. Pasaron los años en Colombia, empecé a tocar, toqué con mucha gente. Conocí músicos, obviamente colombianos, pero también conocí músicos del Brasil. Me impactó mucho la música del Brasil y aprendí a tocar bossa novas y todas esas cosas, samba, bayao. Y paralelamente con las otras actividades musicales que tenía, empecé a enseñar, empecé a conocer la música colombiana un poco después, empecé a conocer la música colombiana, y poco a poco me vi envuelto más en la música colombiana y el jazz. Pasaron una cantidad de años, más o menos en el 2000, yo ya estaba pensando en venir acá, pero pasaron otros 7 años, en los cuales tuve diferentes experiencias musicales con grupos, acompañando cantantes. Tuve oportunidad de trabajar en shows de televisión, y vivía bastante ocupado, tuve la oportunidad de estar bastante ocupado en mi país con la música durante todo ese tiempo. Después, en 2007, yo vine acá con mi hijo Alejandro. Vinimos a establecernos acá, a buscar oportunidades, y de hecho empezamos a encontrarlas. Conocí ciertos músicos por referencia que me habían dado en Colombia. Yo tenía los teléfonos de algunos amigos también que habían venido acá. Me conecté con ellos, empecé a tocar con ellos. Poco a poco empecé a conectarme con la comunidad aquí, con los músicos. Hay un pianista que recuerdo mucho, con el cual estoy muy agradecido, que se llama José Gallegos. Él me dio la oportunidad de tocar con una buena banda, con buenos músicos, y eso fue una experiencia increíble para mí. Después conocí los músicos de Folk Colombia. Folk Colombia es una especie de asociación o de colectivo de músicos y bailarines colombianos dedicados al folclore colombiano. Después se formó una escuela de música y danza en la cual yo participé durante unos 4 o 5 años. Todavía sigue la escuela, pero debido a esta pandemia las actividades pararon, porque esas actividades las hacíamos en escuelas públicas o en iglesias, en lugares que conseguíamos para poder llevar a los niños, enseñarle a los niños, principalmente de hijos de inmigrantes colombianos o ecuatorianos o mexicanos, más que todo gente latina. Bueno, con el tiempo conocí a George también, gracias a que Jorge Arevalo, el director del proyecto en Folk Colombia, me lo presentó, y ahí lo conocí. Grabamos una entrevista, después vino la presentación de Queen's Museum, y ahora estoy aquí con ustedes compartiendo esta experiencia. Bueno, yo en general me he sentido bien en New York, en general, pero al principio fue muy difícil porque, pues por el idioma principalmente. Y porque yo venía con la expectativa de empezar a trabajar con la música inmediatamente, y eso no se dio inmediatamente. Yo tuve que hacer otros trabajos, tuve que aceptar otros trabajos. De hecho, continuaba haciendo otros trabajos paralelamente a la música. Pero todavía mi aspiración es dedicarme completamente a la música. Entre otras cosas, en este tiempo de la pandemia he tenido la oportunidad de hacerlo, porque las únicas cosas que he hecho ha sido música. Lo único que he hecho es música, que parece un regalo de Dios. Bueno, en cuanto a las... Bueno, poco a poco empecé a sentirme mejor. Ahora yo me siento como en casa, realmente. Estoy muy agradecido por las experiencias que he tenido, agradecido con Dios que me regala todas estas experiencias que he tenido, las oportunidades que he tenido con la música y por la gente que he conocido. He conocido muchos músicos, he podido tocar con bastantes músicos de diferentes nacionalidades y diferentes culturas, y eso es fascinante. Parte del propósito de venir acá se ha venido cumpliendo, que era ese, conocer otra cultura, a otros músicos y experimentar cómo se vive la música afuera de mi país, y lo he logrado, gracias a Dios.
Thank you so much to Rafael for recording that for us. Yeah, I just love that. And actually, one of the things that we weren't able to include just for length, but that I want to plug here is Rafael's book. And actually, you might have caught a little snippet in the first half of The Emigrants, where one of the speakers is talking about writing his second book. That's Rafael, and it's a book that is available in English as well and online. And I was sort of previewing it, clicking through it this morning. It is so cool. It's called Colombian Rhythms on the Drum Set. And hopefully that link worked. I'm still getting used to this new platform. But yeah, either click the link or copy paste it into a new tab. And I'd highly encourage you to check it out. Even if you are not a drummer, there are tons of little musical samples in there. Actually, I suspect that was the clip that we watched earlier in the first segment. Was one of those audio samples, and just tons of really valuable and interesting information about folk music in Colombia. So please do check that out. Next we'll cue up the second half, movements 3, 4, and 5 of The Emigrants. And b- before that to sort of lead us in just a quick clip of Rafael playing at the Queen's Museum, where this piece was premiered, at the Queen's Museum with the pianist Jeffrey Ernst. Oh goodness, hang on, let me pull up the name of the song because that is important. It's La Gata Golosa, which is sort of a popular, sort of an oldie but a goodie, old popular Colombian song written by the composer Fulgencio Garcia. And again, this is Rafael Leal and Jeffrey Ernst.
And find a common language that we could speak.
Music is the only thing that is not bound by words.
And find a common language that we could speak.
We cannot express everything we feel with words because words will limit you back.
Because I have a Japanese heritage, I probably can express more things through this music.
So I have to actually compare my instrument to a sitar to make them understand what it is. And trying to have my music speak to them, that's a challenge.
Last year, actually, I published a book for kids. So at this specific time, what I'm doing right now, I'm translating that book into Spanish. I'm translating that book into Spanish. So it takes me a lot to make a version in Spanish. Believe it or not, the translation is not easy.
And trying to have my music speak to them, that's a challenge.
Translating, they say, how you would say this?
And I would say I was lucky enough to find musicians from other styles and to be able to work with them. And find a common language that we could speak.
Music is the only thing that is not bound by words.
I thought I could do something with my music, but differently. Even with my traditional background, I thought I would be able to play Carnatic music, maybe not in the sense what I was doing back in India, but something with a different take, with a different dimension.
How do officers manage all these images we see after regular, ordinary day of work? What do they do to get this out of their heads? That's because for me, I got turned to music. Music is the only thing that is not bound by words.
Because I have a Japanese heritage, I probably can express more things through this music.
So I have to actually compare my instrument to a sitar to make them understand what it is. And trying to have my music speak to them, that's a challenge.
We cannot express everything we feel with words, because words will limit you back. So you change. People change day by day, or even hour by hour. You notice it. You get old. You talk different.
I would definitely say this is really a God-given gift. And find a common language that we could speak. And then I decide to stay. I have created a place for myself here.
But maybe for a while we are staying in New York, and we'd like to continue our musical adventure in this city.
Since that time, I have lived here continuously, and trying to make a living with the music, but it's not too easy.
Yeah, that was very tough. Well, mostly you have to tell your mother on the phone, you know what, I'm not coming back. I just want to see how I can do here. And then I decide to stay. I decide to not come back.
No, I am settled here.
The reason is because my son is here with me. He's studying. I want to give support to him.
And then I decide to stay. I decide to not come back.
No, I am settled here.
But I am looking for new opportunities.
Each of opportunities is really, really important for us.
Why should all the world-class cultural institutions be based in Manhattan? My dream is that 20, 30 years from now, we're going to have a world-class professional level community orchestra residing in Corona.
My name is Harold Gutierrez. I am a Colombian professional musician living in New York since 2000.
My name is Rafael Leal. I'm from Colombia. I am a drummer, percussionist.
My name is Nivedita ShivRaj. I'm a Carnatic musician.
Okay, my name is Hikaru Tamaki. I'm a cellist.
Well, my name is Kakit Yip. I like to go by the name of Chris.
My name is Yoko, Reikano, Kimura. Yoko, Reikano, Kimura is my stage name.
But I am looking for new opportunities.
Thank you to New Morse Code, to George, to all of the speakers, and to all of you for listening in to that stream of this wonderful new recording. As I was listening to it again just now, the line, why should all the world-class cultural institutions be based in Manhattan? That's when I knew this was a piece after my own heart as a leader with Five Bros Music Festival. And that's so much of what we're all about is just showing all of the richness that is right in front of us, in all of the boroughs of this incredible and diverse city. Thank you for listening into this. I guess the other thing that was sort of coming to mind is my own. It's definitely not even a emigration story, but sort of in the process of officially relocating from Boston to New York, and even thinking about all of the little fears that come along with that, and especially at this time, how do I get a new driver's license? How do I, get health insurance in a new state and things like that? And just thinking about that experience magnified many, many times. It's this incredible source of richness that we get to experience as New Yorkers. Thank you all. And now I'm about to invite George, Hannah, Michael, and Rafael on to the stream. The screen can only fit 4 boxes, so I will step off and just let them lead a conversation. If you have any questions, if you've been watching and have any questions about the piece, please feel free to type those into the chat. Otherwise, I know they'll have plenty of meaty subjects to dig into. So I will just transfer over to them. Just one moment.
Hey, everyone. Hello, we're back. It's so great to be here virtually with you all again after our stint at the Queen's Museum in December of 2018. And as Michael hinted at spoke about, the piece was premiered in the Queen's Museum in December 2018, which was a fitting place because all of the speakers in the piece are musicians who are based in and or works in Queens. Of course, Rafael being one of them as well. So, and we invited Rafael along with Duo Yumeno to perform their music along with us as well. And as Michael mentioned, if you're out there in Facebook land watching, if you have any questions and or anything you want to ask us, please feel free to put it in the chat. But for now, I guess I wanted to start by talking with Rafael because we haven't seen you this morning yet live. So how have you been? How are you?
Very good. Very happy to be here with you guys. Very happy.
Yeah. So glad to have you here. So what was it like to hear your voice and your interview voice instead of your musical voice? As you know, what is it like to hear that piece and hearing your story in context of everything?
Every day, I feel good.
That's great. I just loved it when I remember when I first went to your apartment and sat down with you and talked. It was such a great experience to hear about all of your stories from how you got to New York City and why you stayed. And also, I mean, Mike and Hannah, what was it like to sort of work so intimately with all of these voices and also with Rafael's, of course?
Oh man, I can jump in first. I mean, for me, it was really transformative because, you know, it's one thing to get to know someone, but to George, in the piece you'd written that we're supposed to kind of play in complete synchronicity with some of the people's recordings, and we're using the other recordings as sort of a jumping off point. So I feel as we learned the piece, we got to know these recordings and to some extent the people through how they talk, what they're talking about, the pitch and rhythm and cadence of their voice. And for me, it was really fantastic to feel as though I really came closer to someone through your piece. Hannah, I don't know if you felt the same way.
Oh, definitely. I mean, there's something really interesting about encountering a voice in a musical context. And like Meg mentioned, it's sort of each of these voices is so distinct that even though for us, you know, they're collaged together, we absolutely know who's who based on the tone, the pitch, the rhythm, the way, the hesitation, how lyrical, how, you know, so it's a beautiful thing.
Mm-hmm.
Can I ask you a question, George?
Yeah.
I was just noticing this time, listening to this again, you know, just how beautifully organized the different sort of topics are. And I was just wondering, you know, as you collected interviews, what that process was like for you, if you already had an idea that you might, you know, divide into different sections of this piece or whether those emerged naturally. The one that really sticks out to me always is the decision to come separately from the decision to stay, which is something that, like my own family history, my grandparents who emigrated here, I asked them once, you know, if they sort of knew that they wouldn't be returning. And they just said, in that moment, we knew we had to go this way. And that was a separate thing, you know?
Yeah, I think that's an interesting point. As I was putting together the interview questions for the field work, I actually had an idea to specifically ask, why did you stay and why did you not decide to not go back, right? Because I, you know, the piece is of course called The Emigrants, and I was more interested in thinking about what would the experience like leaving a country, leaving your home, you know? And so from there, I interviewed, I had the opportunity to talk with 7 wonderful musicians. And then I listened to all the interviews, I transcribed them all myself. And then I just poured through the transcripts, looking for themes. So for example, that leaving part, of course, that's sort of hard-coded in there because I asked the question, it's sort of leading. But the other theme that came out was in learning and also teaching. So of course, Rafael, you know, you teach and you're writing a book, or you wrote a book about, you know, teaching people, you know, and that's a very common theme for all of us, you know, as musicians who have been taught and is a natural extension to also teach. And especially for immigrant musicians, that's especially another thing they can, you know, make money from. And also that's part of really a big part of their livelihood, especially for music from other cultures, right? So that also became another theme that I could sort of wrap my head around. But it was that was actually somewhat challenging, but also fun after I figured out how to organize everything. Before I forget, Rafael, tell us about your book, which we've been talking about. So this is a book that I posted a link on in the Emigrants website, but also it's on the Facebook chat, right, everyone? Yeah, so can you tell us a little bit more about the book?
Yes, this book is focused in Colombian rhythms and the role the drum set is playing about the rhythms, how to orchestrate the sounds of the original drums, the folkloric drums on the drum set, different ways to do it. Also, the book has all the examples I wrote in the book have audio files and little pieces. I wrote little pieces to at the end of each example to show the exercise and the groups in context, in musical context.
That's great.
Yes.
Yeah. And it's so cool to think about the, you know, integrating Colombian folk rhythms into whatever drum style you're playing in jazz or rock. I think that's, you know, and the idea of writing, you know, an etude, as it were, also something that I've found to be interesting in translating that to the themes that came out. Hannah Michael, do you want to talk about what you're doing now and also, you know, future projects?
Sure. Mike just mentioned that we are in the midst of a recording project of one of the other new Morse Connections pieces, which is an opera by the composer Susan Kander and librettist Roberta Gumbel, who's also the star of the show. I think she's watching now, so I'm... So Roberta wrote this beautiful libretto about the experience of teaching her African-American son how to drive in the context of all the, you know, potential biases or just fears and dangers he may face as a young Black man driving, you know, through the roads of this country and just confronting some of those news stories and events that we've all been aware of, while also just trying to, you know, show him love and protection and courage and all the things that a mother wants to share with her son. So we were meant to perform this in New York City at Brook Center for the Performing Arts in March, and unfortunately, due to the pandemic, it was canceled, postponed. So we're making a film version that can be shared with the help of Brooke Center for the Performing Arts. So that is our big project at this instant.
Yeah. So stay tuned, because in October this video of Driving While Black will be part of a number of sort of live screenings of this of the movie, combined with some conversations with everybody involved. So stay tuned for that.
Yay, that's so cool. Sorry, I had to unmute myself. Well, no, that's really exciting, really looking forward to that.
Yeah, I mean, I guess I would say that I was thinking about this, listening to the piece again, and then listening to Rafael talk, and what's been so amazing about this process, and I'm so grateful for, is that it involved, for us, a lot of listening. And I remember when you came to Kansas, George, and we filmed that little kind of informational trailer about the video, you know, we were thinking a lot about how a lot of the conversation in the country about immigration was sort of about these big concepts of immigration, or a lot of the conversation about racial bias and policing was sort of generalized. And what's been really great about these projects is the ability to just hear people tell their stories. And that reframing, or that tiny little shift to just listening instead of talking, has been really, really amazing. And it's something that I know that Hannah and I are taking with us in everything that we do kind of going forward from here. It was just sort of a sidebar that had been building up for me, listening to the piece again and listening to all of you talk about this project.
Yeah, I think, you know, just shifting the conversation just a little bit and hearing the words as music has always been really interesting to me. You know, of course, lots of composers have done similar things, and it has continued to be fascinating to think about the words as music. But of course, words also have meaning, and so it's like a double whammy. You get two things at once, and I think, you know, for me, as you know, as you mentioned, Michael, I think that's the magic of some of this stuff, that's really trying to make a connection with everyday life and everyday people. Yeah. Anything else that anyone want to add to this?
Just on that topic, George, Arthur Leonard in the Facebook chat just mentioned the soliloquy movement. And
oh, yeah.
Just sort of maybe a different way of thinking about it, mentioning that wordless movement kind of shows that music can surpass words in certain kinds of expression. And a question for you is just, where did that movement come from? Why did you choose to put that there?
Yeah, that's interesting. I think I'm always one for drama. I've worked a lot with different kinds of opera and also in theater. And you know, when I'm thinking about something that's about 15 to 20 minutes long, if it's all talking, you're going to get bored and you might tune out. So having you, the audience, having to wait and figure out, you know, wait a second, you know, the cello is still going on, but there's no speaking yet, creates a kind of drama, creates a little bit of tension. So that was the main reason why I wanted to put that in the two-thirds mark of the piece. But also, as Arthur, you know, you mentioned, I think that's a part of it, right? So after you hear all these words about musicians playing music generally without words, so all of the musicians, they're playing different instrumental music, right? And they're talking about music. And so it seemed like it was a good place to just have a little bit of meditation, but also again a bit of drama, and you know, and asking you, the audience, to wait and find out, well, is this it? Will it, you know, will things come back? And of course, when the words do come back, I chose, I think, something from Harold Gutierrez. Said something like, and then I stayed, or something like that. And so I wanted to highlight that last bit of the last movement of the piece about people staying, about people, you know, figuring out we're not gonna go back. Which reminded me, when I was little, I moved away from Hong Kong in the 90s when there was a wave of emigration for folks who were really nervous about the transition from British rule back to the People's Republic of China. And so at that time, I know all of my friends, a lot of my friends from school, they were all leaving. And at that time, when you're leaving, you're basically leaving, very, very similar to, you know, getting on a boat. You know, because it was so expensive to fly, it has since gotten so much, you know, more accessible. But at that time, I do remember that sense of, you know, hey, we're just leaving. We're just going to make it in New York, or we're going to make it somewhere. And anyway, so that's I wanted to highlight that as well with the solo cello. Cool. It's so nice to be able to spend this time with you, and also just to listen to the piece again, and also to listen to the wonderful interview, Rafael, in Spanish. That was so great. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you.
And I mean, your English is also really great. So but I've only heard you speak in English, and so this is a treat to also get to hear your thoughts in your native tongue. Before I close out and hand it back to Michael, I just want to mention again, the piece is supported by New Morse Connections, a bunch of really great supporters of New Morse Code. Contributed to a Kickstarter project that supported three pieces, one of which is this. Also supported by grants from the City University of New York, and then also in partnership with the Queens Museum. And then also, if you are just joining us, Rafael Leal's book is available on Google, the Google Bookstore. And then also, Mike and Hannah, your piece is coming up in October. For the video premiere, so we're looking forward to that. Yeah, so I'm gonna hand it back to Michael, who is going to, I think, conclude the stream.
Thanks, George, thanks everybody.
Thanks, George, yeah, thank you everybody. Great to see you.
Nice to see you.
Thank you all so much, George, Hannah, Mike, and Rafael, for that conversation, for collaborating on this piece, for really everything that's gone into this. Thank you so much. It's been, it's been a really wonderful week for me, just diving into this piece and getting to know it, getting to know all of you. So really, thank you so much. Closing thoughts. Yeah, George and New Morse Code, Hannah and Michael, I think they may be able to stick around a little bit if there happen to be any last questions on the Facebook chat. And beyond that, please, again, check out The Emigrants on Bandcamp. Pick up a copy of the album. Pick up a copy of Rafael's book from the link that we posted. It really is so interesting and thinking about, you know, the experience of, you know, moving to a country where you don't speak the language and then publishing a book is just something I can't even imagine doing. But this book is really awesome and really fascinating. And also check out Rafael's work at Folk Columbia. That's one word. Just Google that. Check out all the awesome sort of teaching work and performing work that they've done, and you know, hopefully that will be starting up again very soon. And just one last reminder, again, if you enjoyed this, consider making a little donation to 5BMF through Facebook or through our page 5BMF/support. And finally, we'll just play one last tune by Rafael, appropriate for the brunch hour that we find ourselves in. This is a tune, again, with Jeffrey Ernst called Scrambled Eggs.